Call the November 9th, 2015, USD 350 Board of Education meeting order. I'd like to welcome all visitors here. We've got Rodney Fox, Mr. and Mrs. Henry, Ms. Graber, Julianne Owens, Mark Fire, Carol Ray. Additions or changes to the agenda?
There are none.
Entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
Mr. President, I move to approve the agenda as presented.
Moved and seconded to approve the agenda as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried 6-0. Consent agenda?
Nothing unusual there. We have our second meeting of the month. That special meeting would be different than normal. And then the financial reports, you have that updated financial reports that includes the bank rec, so that would replace what's on the receipt.
Entertain a motion to approve.
Mr. President, move the board approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
It's moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried 6-0. Any patron comments tonight?
Not down. I'm going to wait until you got down there to get on the
Okay, we can allow you a few minutes when we get down to your topic. Okay. All right, we'll move on to the business agenda. First up, teacher presentation.
I will introduce, this is Kate Graber, she's a second grade teacher, and Brad Emery is a third grade teacher, and they've each got one of these new smart boards in their classroom. I'm not going to tell you about it, they're going to show you about it.
Well, kind of took my introduction to my plan, so I'll just jump right to it. These are the smart boards that Brad and I both got this year. Couple, 2-3 weeks ago, I would say, and they work really well. Here in second grade, we do anywhere from reading, phonics, grammar, spelling, math, science, social studies, handwriting. And so the beginning of the year was a little chaotic for me, first year teacher, I'm only a couple months into it, turning in work and things like that. So the first thing that I got and created when we got these smart boards was a turn-in stations spreadsheet. Just do it in Word, I have all their names listed, and so when they get something done, they get to come and they press it. This they always struggle with. There's a keyboard that they can pull down, and then all they have to do is erase their name. So they get to come up. You can do it pen, finger, like I've been doing it. Either way, really interactive. They love doing it. We're still working on some lesson interaction, but I've got a little bit that I'm going to show you what we've done and what we plan to do. So this is just one of the things I wanted to show you that I do for my classroom, a little bit of classroom management. Something that I do is demonstrating handwriting. Right now we are in cursive. Please forgive my cursive skills. So I demonstrate up here on the board, and then they get to do it in their handbooks. I have them come and sit around. We do, as you see, some of them are more straight than others. I do wrong ones. They tell me which ones are wrong and which one's the best, things like that. One of the things that I show you that we will do on Wednesday is this is our Go Math series. And so what we do is sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. I haven't figured out where it works and where it doesn't. Hopefully the sum works. Find some. Just a little bit of math that we do. I'm just going to show you. There's a couple of math problems at the end, and if anyone's brave enough to come up and punch in an answer, you're more than welcome to. But I'll just kind of show you what second grade math looks like or what it will on Wednesday. We call him Yogi.
Hi there. You know, I hadn't noticed all the lily pads along the riverbank. They make such a pretty sight. I like this group over here. I wonder how many lily pads there are. Click that lily pad to count them.
And so then you can see it turns yellow. So normally when we're doing group instruction, I'll click on it just so that they're not up and running around.
Now I can count them better. Looks like 9 lily pads to me. What do you think? Oh, look, here's another 4 lily pads. Now, how many do you think there are? You know, there must be a way to figure this out. What if I put one of these lily pads with the first group? Come on, let's see what we can find out.
So then the air is yellow.
There are 5 dog bones. There are 5 dog biscuits. The addition sentence for the model is 5 + 5 = 10. Here is a different model. What if there are 6 dog bones and 4 dog biscuits? The addition sentence for the model is 6 + 4 = 10. Here is a different model. Suppose there are 7 dog bones and 3 dog biscuits. Click to see the addition sentence for the model.
Okay, so the idea for them on Wednesday is to create the number 10 as their anchor. So if they're gonna do a 4 plus, or an 8 plus 7, they're gonna transfer that 7 into a 2 plus 5. So then they can do 10 plus 5 is 15, just to kind of make it easier or give the kids another way if they can't just automatically know 8 plus 7. I'm gonna try and skip and see if we can just do the personal math trainer, C.
Now let's practice with the personal math trainer.
Perfect. So then this option gives us 2 that we do together as a class. So then I will read it. There are 9 bees in a hive. How many more bees need to go to the hive for there to be 16? So then they're able to say, okay, well, some of them, they'll sit there and they'll count their fingers, say, okay, I need 1 more to get to 10. Then 10 to 16 is 6, 6 plus 1 is 7. And, oh, not right. Okay. Sometimes you can't type in the number. I haven't ever been able to. And so then we check our answer. Do the next one.
So you can run your board from over here?
I can, and that's the nice thing about it, is sometimes when they're going and they want to go up and they want to erase their name and they're just press, they'll go and Daniel will then erase Weston's name. So I can see that happen if I'm over here and say, okay, freeze. And they love to freeze. They actually will literally freeze. I'll tell them second grade freeze. I'll go back and type Weston, move down to Daniel, and Daniel can continue erasing his name or something like that. So it is. It's gone blank a couple times and I love being able to see what they're doing. But if anyone is willing or wants to come up and solve this one, Max is thinking of a devil's fact. It has a sum that's greater than the sum of 6 plus 4 and less than the sum of 7 plus 7. What's the devil fact that he can use?
So you're saying in the 14 it'd be...
So we would work this out together and saying, well, it has a sum that's greater than 6 plus 4. Well, what is 6 plus 4?
10.
Okay?
Should be.
But it also has to be less than the sum of 7 plus 7. And what is 7 plus 7?
14.
14. So it has to be between 10 and 14. So which devil's fact has the answer of a number that is greater than 10 but less than 14? Is that A, B, C, or D? Does someone want to come click B? Just to see what it's like? Or you just trust me to push B?
We'll trust you.
Okay, so they can press B then and check it. So that's kind of, we don't do this every day, obviously. Sometimes we watch this because they like the bear, other times I teach, other times we do partner learning, things like that. So we don't use this every time, but they do like the bear. So, yeah?
When they do a test, they're not tested on the state assessments, are they, in second grade? Since start of third grade?
Starts at third grade,
so
yeah.
This would be similar to what a third grade test, other than harder facts? Word problems and then the...
Similar, yeah. They're still adjusting at the Common Core. They really don't know what they're doing yet, so it's kind of touchy at best. So, yeah.
So this is just an example of something that we've done in math before. Interactive, they're able to come up and do this. Let's see, one of the other lessons that I had planned is it's different ways to represent a number, and this is actually one that they've done. If you can't tell that that's not my handwriting, then we're in huge trouble. But it's four different ways to represent the number in the triangle, and so they had to tell me that they have four hundreds, one, ten, and five ones. As you can see, anytime that they come in right, oh, and I always do this, and then they always laugh. They come in right, and my finger happens to touch, it'll draw two, but no big deal. So then they can represent using hundreds, tens, and ones blocks. They work on expanded form. That was what chapter two was about, was different ways to represent numbers. Then they write it, they spell it out. We're working on spelling, too. So, I can create a number if you would like to come up and write on the board. Would anyone want to write on the board?
I'm just going to have to pick somebody.
I'm just going to have to pick someone? In second grade, I'd have to draw names from a... Well, actually, I would. They'd all raise their hand. But in order to make it fair, I'd have to draw names. And it's not pretty right now. I could do a shape, but it just takes so much more time and my back is then turned to them. So if I do 121, and I just draw a line, if someone isn't willing, I will call. No?
Oh, Ken said he would. I know, I heard that.
You can choose any way to write. You can write it in expanded form, telling you the value of the number in the hundreds, the tens, and the ones. You can draw it with blocks. I pick an easy number. You can spell it out any way you choose. No one? No one? No one?
Yeah.
My kids are so much eager than you guys to write on the board.
So, for example, 100
mm-hmm.
plus 20
mm-hmm.
plus.
Yep, plus. Absolutely. Expanded form. Mm-hmm. And then you can even, if you want, you can even, there's shapes up here, you can draw a shape, you can pick it.
Say I messed that up and I wanted to erase it.
Eraser. Or I have, like, I can click on it and it just erases it. Or if I click on it and, oops, the eraser, and you go big and you can just erase something.
So much cleaner than the board.
I'll show you this. I have a, let's see. Sometimes, I haven't quite figured out what works and what doesn't. Like why sometimes I can double click and why sometimes I don't. I did a...
So could you carry a wireless mouse?
Yeah.
And then that way you can just stand over there.
Other than I have to have these wires plugged in, but yeah, I could if I just wanted to hold my laptop. The thing I haven't figured out is a lot of the teachers, they have the Apple TVs, and so they'll plug in their iPad and use it as like a camera so that then they can prop their iPad up higher than the sheet. And then write on the sheet on their Apple TV so that you can do it with the kids while they see it. I haven't figured out a way to do that. I don't have the right plug-in. to do that. So like giving instructions for like a phonics sheet, things like that. Unless I have the actual electronic document on my computer, I am able to access it. I can't do that worksheet with them. This math series, I had found I could go page by page. And so it's got the page by page. And so it'll show my page on the TV as they're seeing it on an actual worksheet page from their math book, but I'm not able to actually write on it. It doesn't flip-flop over to that. So, but yeah.
I was just wondering about a clicker, you know, a pointer. That's what I want to say. Can you put a pointer on there and point instead of walking back? Because that wouldn't cost that much to fix that up.
I'd
save you some.
I don't know how much that costs.
I'll show you some.
Okay.
Really, if the settings are right, if we get it all tweaked, she should be able to operate anything on there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
On that screen.
So that's just a little bit of what we do in our second grade classroom. Oh, do you have any questions for me, or want to see something else that we've done, or?
Do you think the kids are more involved this way, or do they? Even attention, you know, young kids don't keep attention for long.
Yeah, and I mean, we do things like this in handwriting. I play Kids Bop Pandora, and when it comes through the TV, it's nice and loud other than just from my laptop. So that keeps them quiet. We do brain breaks, and so they're able to actually, like, do. There's a Halloween Freeze song that we've been doing the last couple of weeks, and it lets them, like, be monsters. And so they actually get to see it. And do it instead of just listening to a song on my iPad or my laptop or putting it on the TV, and they're all like hurting their eyes because they're so close. Yeah, they love it. They love coming up, and I'm still trying to learn ways to interact, let them interact with it more. I mean, as you can see, we're still learning. We're learning how, but yeah, they're definitely.
How many smart boards do we have currently? We've got these two that are in the TV style, and then we've got Mr. Kinneman has one that's operating from the projector, and there's one down in the computer lab here. I think Mrs. Kinneman has one.
So, half dozen. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
What's in the English rooms? That's not smart?
No. Brad, did you want to show us?
I actually haven't set up the other room, so if you don't
you do.
Mind a field trip, if that's okay.
Sure.
Okay. We'll head that way. So that when you tap one, you automatically jump to a category. So for example, if we're playing Jeopardy, we have an interactive whiteboard that uses touch to help engage students, which would be?
Smartboard.
A smart board. And you can come down here, and actually I would have the kids do this, and they can move this and find out that they do have the correct answer. You've got a link that jumps right back to the beginning, and we can take a little bit of a closer look here at some of the other features. So, looking a little more at smart boards, they may be used to engage students in all different content areas, and I'm going to show you a few of those different areas and the ways that you can use a smart board in them. Just to get your minds running here. First off, have somebody come up and tap the pin. We can just go around the room if you like. That way you don't have to go through it. If you will come up and tap the pin, and then you can try writing your name up there.
I'm terrible.
Once you start writing up there, it'll look worse than anything you do on paper. But it's still kind of fun to try. Absolutely. So you can program in particular objects to link to tools. So if the kids are having a little trouble operating your actual tools, you can put a picture of an eraser in there, and it's really easy to just right-click it and tell it, link to the eraser tool, so that they can tap the eraser, go in, and clear their page or whatever they need to do, just like we did with the pen. I don't have an eraser set up, but one of the other neat features about the eraser, if you've got a big chunk of text you're wanting to take care of, you can actually run it around in a circle, and then tap in the middle and it'll all disappear. So, makes things a little bit quicker. The kids pick up on this stuff far faster than I do, which is fun to watch, but a little disconcerting sometimes as well.
So a couple of things you can do with the smart boards. Let's get into a little more content area here. If we're looking at math, this is one of my favorite tools that I found actually this afternoon. These are random number generators, so I can set it up to produce a number between any given parameters. They emit, or originally had it set up between negative 500 and 500, obviously a little too much for third graders. So I reprogrammed it for a third grade game that we played called Can You Make It? You start off by tapping this, and it'll give you a random number here, and this would be our target number. So down here, I've already got some program, but if we wanted to, we could come up with different numbers, and every time you tap this, it's randomly generating a number between 0 and 9. And then once we get it, you can tap this arrow, and it will come out here to where the kids can manipulate it and use it. Now, what they do is they use the 5 numbers, or in our case, 6, and they're trying to use those in any way to make their target number of 10. So, using addition and subtraction, your job is to create a problem that will give you the number 10. So I'll give you a minute to think about that. Now with the kids, I tell them that you can make a number. I don't mind if you use the 7 and the 4 to make 74, but the trick is you can only use each number once. Now with the smart board, it's nice because when they move a number, they see that it goes away, so they can't have like 77 because they only have 1. So if they make 74, they can come in and they can subtract 64 from that to give them 10. Now you may notice when I'm taking things from over here, the plus, minus, equals, they don't move. The reason for that is you can set up an object where it can be cloned an infinite number of times, so that if you're using math manipulatives or different tools that you want kids to be able to reproduce, you can just right-click, make them an infinite clone, and they can use that as much as they want, which is really great for if you're doing things like you're going to see here with another math problem we have, where they're using base 10 blocks so that they can get more of a hands-on experience. Now, when I've done this in the classroom, I've had one student or myself demonstrate up on the board while the rest of them have the physical manipulative, so everyone's engaged, they're all doing it. They can see it and they can do it. I usually have them work out the problem first, then they come up and they show us how that looks. So on a problem like this, you would start with your hundreds, and this really is a good way to meet the Common Core standards, because what you're doing is you're letting the kids move, feel, and see these problems that are really abstract. I mean, the way you and I learned them was a standard algorithm. You put 255 and then you subtracted 132. The goal of this is to get the kids to where they're comfortable moving those numbers around and making new, by carrying and breaking apart numbers in order to subtract what they need to subtract. So they would start with the ones, and you'd take away the ones. They would obviously remove two of those, and I just have them toss them below to make them disappear. They're still down there if you were to scroll down, but for the sake of having the time, we just toss them out of the way. And then they'd have to break up the tens, so they could toss one of those, and then they can grab the 10 ones. That way they're not actually losing anything. It's all still right here. They get that hands-on experience. Once they're done with that, I didn't put in a pen tool, but they could go ahead and write out whatever their answer was and have it there for their keepers. One of the other features that's come in really handy, and I have not used it with the kids yet, another one I found this afternoon, but I'm excited to use with the kids, we're currently working on measurement. So, they're doing a lot of things with different rulers, and they're very complex. Third graders struggle with rulers, all those different marks, and frankly, some of them they have aren't very clear. So it's nice to have something like this where they can come up and they can move it around and measure it, see it with their friends, with their peers, and have a very concrete idea of what this is. So they can bring this up here, measure it, put it exactly on the line, and they can round it to the nearest inch, half inch, quarter inch. But the way to check their answers is they bring this little arrow down. If they're rounding it to the nearest half inch, they put that arrow on the nearest half inch. Once they've done that, they hit the arrow down here, and it gives them an answer to check. So they've already written theirs, they can find out if they were right, 4.5 inches. When you move that arrow on the ruler, it will adjust your output also to whatever you need. So, good way for them to check their answers. They're doing it, they're not hearing me tell them, because I've got a few that when teacher tells them something, it obviously isn't right. So, seeing it is a much better way. If a computer tells them, apparently it knows more than I do. So, which is probably more true than I care to admit. Reading gives you a few opportunities to interact with it. I haven't really gotten as in-depth with the reading as I would like. So, right now we've used it for a lot of different grammatical sort of things, checking sentences, finding verbs, nouns. Obviously, you can use the pen, as we've done in the past, to go through. You can underline verbs, circle. You can do editing checklist, which the Common Core has emphasized grammar. That was one of the things we saw in the state assessments last year that really gave the kids a lot of trouble. So we're focusing on grammar. We do a grammar lesson every day. Usually we use this, and a lot of times I'll use that in conjunction with our document camera here. The Smart Board has some software in there that's called Smart Ink. Right now we're using a Smart Notebook program, which is exactly what Kate was using also, which lets you do things all within the notebook. The Smart Ink is this little circle you see over here, and theoretically, it will let you write on any other window you have open. So if I open something up on the document camera, it runs through the computer and supposed to be able to, anything I put on here, write on the computer. So I'll see if that will work. It's a little bit finicky. You open up ImageMate, and what this is it's sending the document camera signal into the computer, which is broadcasting it over to our screen. And I can actually adjust it right here. So you can see any document you have. Kate was talking about doing this with an iPad, which you could also do. The downside of doing it with an iPad is because it's not running through your computer, you would not be able to use the Smart Ink program. So that would be an unfortunate side effect. However, not enough that I could be worried about it. So once it works, you can write on here on any document that you have. And it will actually stay there even if you move the document itself. And then you can move those particular little pieces around by selecting them. So if you put something in the wrong place, you can move it back down, or if I bump my paper. And that will stay up as long as I have the window open. I can actually screenshot this if I wanted to save something for later. If I've got a paper up here I'm using the kids to write on, I don't want them to actually have my handwriting on their paper. This is a great tool so that I can write on their paper without actually doing it. Another neat feature about this Smart Ink is it's got a built-in recorder. So anything I can do on the screen, I can take a video of it. And you can actually hook up a mic. I've not tried this yet, but I could record lessons so that if a kid was homesick, you could post it online and they could go online and they could see the same lesson that everyone else did. They could hear it. They could physically see what's happening. So, kind of a neat feature. We'll go ahead and close out of that and bring back our Smart Notebook to show you a little more about reading. The other big way that I use it in reading is more of a fill-in-the-blank sort of thing. See if this is the right one. Yes. You can set up a Venn diagram, and then you can set up a word box and bring over words into the appropriate spots. So they've got this interactive feel to it. What I really liked about this is when we were doing the state assessments last year, they have a multidisciplinary standardized test, which pretty much they're wanting to use technology for more than A, B, C, or D, or a drop-down box. And this is some of the stuff that they're putting in on that test. Unfortunately, the kids don't have touch screens for that, but this gives them some good practice with moving things around, and hopefully will make them more comfortable by the time they get to those assessments that they're taking this year, so that they're familiar with that. It's not just a shutdown mode. So, some of the coolest features that they have on the Smart Board take place in science and social studies, because they've got models built in that come with your software and are really easy to find. that are 3D models, but some are even animated. So if you're studying the Earth's core, you have a world here, and the globe will animate, peel back the layers, and then you can even take a step up beyond that, and you can rotate that globe so that you can see different angles, and the kids can come up and do this too. So, kind of some neat features, all built into the SmartBoard software. You get all of this when we downloaded the Smart Notebook, and it's really pretty easy to find. They've got a search bar right over here, and they just have a ton of great resources that you can find. 396 different interactive multimedia things that you can use, hundreds of charts, notebook files, pages, a lot of great stuff that's really easy to access and provides things that we otherwise would not have. I'll show you one more feature. If you operate through Microsoft, they have a touch pack. A few years back, they came out with some big touch screens, and they thought they were going to be these touch screen tables that you could eat on, play games, do this other stuff. Sometimes it does this. So they created a touch pack that's free for anyone that wants to download Microsoft, the tools. We've got some games on here that the kids can use during indoor recess. They love that. And just get them more familiar with the board. But on an educational level, this is one of my favorites. It's much like Google Earth, except because you're on a big screen, it's a touch screen, it feels a lot more interactive, a lot more in-depth, and the kids really like it to get engaged. We do a weekly temperatures, high and low, and then they find the difference between them. So we pull this up every week, and they can see we've got a pin where our school is, and we've even gone down to the classroom level. You've got a satellite map that you can zoom in, bring it all the way into St. John. At this point, all the kids are going, "There's my house! Where's my house?" And you can bring it in all the way and see where our school is, and we have a pin on there so the kids can see where we are in relation to these high and low temperatures throughout the United States. Now, on a social studies level, if you bring this out, take it over into the Rocky Mountains, you can see some nice geographic features by tilting your map. And it gives you a topographical map here that you can move around. And so when we study landforms, the kids will be able to come up here and they'll be able to physically find landforms that are real places. So it becomes far more than just a flat map that you roll down from the wall. And suddenly they get to see, oh wait, this mountain is a lot higher or a lot lower than the one next to it. They can actually see what a canyon is, how the river carves its way through the valley, where they put towns in, where they have roads, and they can even see spots that they've been before. So it gives them a lot more relevant instruction is the idea. A couple of you had questions about things like running it from a place other than the computer. There's a couple of ways you can do that. One of them, you can download a free app if you have an iPhone. It's called Mobile Mouse. You just open that up, and it will automatically connect once you set up the software on here, and it's free download on your computer. And you can actually control your mouse from your iPhone, just like you would with a trackpad. And you can do anything you need on that, and it will, if you buy the, I think it's about $3, they have an app launcher, so you can actually come in and you can launch programs from here. You can type on here and it'll show up, and right click, left click, it's a mouse. It's really nice to move around the room when you've got a kid at the back of the room that's not paying attention. And they're really quite surprised when you show up beside them and then you're still running. So, it's kind of a neat feature. One of the ways that we use it, it's not just limited to smart boards, but the third graders really like it. Kate talked about brain breaks. There's a site called GoNoodle.com that's wonderful for brain breaks. They have most of their videos are about 3 to 4 minutes. Some are even shorter than that. And it's set up on kind of a leveling format, if you will. And you get to pick this little character, and the kids pick it. We're going to just use a demo class here. Otherwise, my kids are going to wonder what's going on. And what this is it's a ton of school-appropriate videos that are designed to get kids up and moving, give them a bit of a brain break, whether it's through stretching or exercise or deep breathing, so that they can sit down and focus again. So anytime I notice the kids getting squirrely, if we've been sitting for 20 minutes listening to me blab, we'll pull up a Go Noodle. They'll get out of their chairs and then right at their desks participate in one of these activities. Everything from Zumba to breathing to yoga. Some of them are more goofy than others. But the nice part about having the smart board is the kids can actually come up and choose, and it doesn't slow down instruction, whereas if you had a computer, some of them are a little bit tech unsavvy. So we turn something like this on. Turn up my song. Make sure the door is closed so no one can see us. I go to the back of the room so I'm not totally embarrassed, and then dance along with the kids. By the time the 3 minutes are up, they're all up, moving, their blood's pumping, and they're ready for more instruction. So, any questions about smart board, things that we can do, software?
Can I come back to third grade?
Yeah, I'm just going to start. I'll just start. Just take one. That's the one. I'll go to that first. A couple of others. Well, it's good to be here. Good to see you all again.
Thank you.
This is the formal audit. I'm not going to go. It's really like deep, but I'm not going to go through page by page. A few things I do want to kind of point out as we go through. So, wait for everybody's left there. Page one and two. One and two. This is our opinion on the financial statements. The rest of the report is basically your financial statements in accordance with the Kansas Municipal County and Audit County. So we issue an opinion as to whether or not financial statement on the notes are fairly presented in all the general respects. So it takes us two pages to kind of say that, but that's what this is. It does talk in there, like we talked about last year, that the financial statement and notes are not in accordance with general respects. That's okay, because every year you all adopt a waiver that allows you to basically use the cash basis budget law or the regulatory basis of accounting for your financial statement presentation. And that's allowed by Kansas statutes. And what that allows you to do is basically present your financial statement on the same basis of accounting that you do your budget. And you're comparing the numbers and the rules for coming up with those numbers are the same for your financial statement as they are. It's just that we're required to, note, again, so that the reader will have to pick up his financial statement, say, and understand that they're not in accordance with general respects. At the top of page two, and I apologize for my voice. I'll make it, but I might go in and out for time. On the top of page two, that's our opinion in accordance with the regulatory basis. Basically, it says in our opinion, and that it's a fairly presented in all the general respects in accordance with the regulatory basis. So it is a clean and qualified opinion. The part about the supplementary information that I'll kind of show you when we get to that, there is a section called regulatory that requires supplementary information. Again, this is the format prescribed by us. But this paragraph here relates to that, and again, it also says that information is fairly presented in all the general respects in accordance with the regulatory. Anybody have any questions on that? Okay. Flip the page to page three and four. This is the financial statement, which we can get kind of an overview of the funds of the district, which is all the revenues, receipts, expenditures, any outcome of cash, encumbrances, and any cash balance. It's comparable to what, on a monthly basis, you get your cash summary report. A little bit different, but comparable. If you look at the ending unencumbered cash column on page four, that column would indicate compliance with the cash basis law. What that says is that municipalities are not allowed to spend or commit to spend in the form of encumbrances more funds than what they have available. So if you kind of go down that column, any negative would indicate possibly a violation of the cash basis law. And again, as you go down that, you see that all of your funds are positive. So that would indicate that you have complied with the cash basis law. Your general fund, remember, with the way the school finance formula works, you know, based on last year for 6/30/15, based on your enrollment, you get so much budget authority, and then you either spend it or transfer it. The state basically, if you don't, then you send it back to the state. So again, it will always come out to zero, close to zero. Any questions on that page?
Okay. If we turn over to, I guess it's page 5, 6, 7, 8 along in there, those are the notes to the financial statements. Those just provide additional explanation and analysis. You know, there's a note in there that talks about basis of accounting. Note C kind of describes some of the differences between the regulatory basis of accounting and then general accepted accounting principles. On page 7, one of the things that was part of our audit in accordance with the Kansas Municipal Accounting Audit Guide is we're required to review the district's compliance with statutes that pertain to the financial operation of the district. And if we note an instance where you didn't comply or require, or basically required that you report that in the audit report. Everything was fine. There was just on note 3, you'll see compliance with Kansas statutes. There was just a short period of time, and the district, the security provided for the funds, the deposit of the district, was short for a short period of time. What happened, and again, it's not uncommon, the bank does a good job of monitoring that on a monthly basis. And at the end of the month, throughout the whole year, was fine. But districts get their state aid from the state at the beginning of the month. And in January, after you got your large tax deposit, then you were fine at the end of January. But then the 1st of February, when that state aid came for a few days, the depository security was a little bit short. So again, for the rest of the year, it was fine. And the year end, it was fine. That's not an uncommon occurrence with the way the school money's kind of, you know, distributed out, because it all does come at the beginning of the month, and then those balances are dropped. And again, like I said, the bank does a good job of monitoring that, and that minimizes the amount of time that one's under security. Does anybody have any questions on that? Okay, you turn the page 9 and 10, kind of using your table. 9 and 10 just shows the long-term debt of the district. Basically, the only things you have outstanding are the lease purchases, lease purchase agreements, one for the building improvements and one for a bus purchase at the end of the year. The bottom part of that shows the maturity. In 5 years, the next 5 years, and then in 5-year increments after that until it's fully paid off, until they're fully paid off. Any questions on that? On page 13 and 14, you might notice right before that, you'll notice there's kind of the divide that says regulatory required supplementary information. That's where, you know, that paragraph that I alluded to in talking in the opinion where it talked about the supplementary information, that's pertaining to this section. And really from here on back is the supplementary information. But page 13 and 14 shows the funds the district are required to be budgeted, shows comparison of expenditures to the budget. Because remember, when you adopt that budget, you know, you set the mill levies necessary to fund the budget. You do that in July and August of each year. But the other thing that you do when you publish that is you set the legal maximum amount that you can spend in any of those funds. So that's why a lot of times you'll hear it referred to as a legal maximum budget. The state's not concerned about line items. If you go over or under, but in total, you can't spend more than what you tell patrons that you're going to spend. So, what this schedule does shows compliance with the budget law. And again, if you look at the variance column,
This compares the legally adopted budget to once again, adjusted for either budget credits or reductions in the legal max because of your enrollment. And then it compares that, it shows variance over or under here. A negative means that you're under budget. So if you go down that column, you know, anything that would be positive would indicate a possible budget law violation. Again, as you go down through that, you'll see that all of them are zero or negative, which means they're all under budget. General fund, you notice, is zero. That's because, you know, you spend your full budget authority based on your legal maximum budget. And again, remember, when we're talking about spending, you're talking about purchasing goods and services or transferring to your special revenue funds. Okay? Okay. The next schedule, Schedule 2, not going to go through that in detail. That just takes, again, each of the funds and kind of shows the detail, shows the prior year receipts and expenditures compared to the current year compared to budget. It's going to be very similar to your budget document that you just adopted here in August. Same kind of format. And again, the numbers that you arrive, you know, with the same basis of accounting. So for the most part, it's going to mirror your budget. If we go on back to page, starting on page 45, this is a little bit different than last year. We added these since this is the second year we've done the audit. This is just some graphical analysis. And again, it just takes the same information from last year's audit, when this year's audit report, and just kind of puts it in graph form kind of deal. As we go, you know, we'll expand that. I think most districts find like a 5-year trend is useful to kind of look at kind of what's happened over the last 5 years. So this right now just shows the 2 years. But again, if you look at that on page 45, where you have the uncovered cash balances in the district, you know, you can kind of see from last year to this year kind of how those have changed. The two things there, and again, you can see this in Schedule 2. To those individual fund statements, but your contingency fund at the end of the year, you approve transferring those funds to your other special revenue funds for budget purposes. So again, you'll notice it when it dropped, but then if you look at like your at-risk fund and your special education fund, you'll notice those cash balances increase. So, and that's the reason for that. The capital outlay, remember that's unencumbered cash. That's cash balances after encumbrances. And you did have a couple fairly large encumbrances at the end of the fiscal year. One was for the track, I think $108,000 or something, like a fire alarm system, $15,000. So this is already taking that out. So this is the cash left over after accounting. For so. Any questions on the audit? That's kind of all I have there. This morning. Again, you know, feel free to look through it if you have questions. Josh, I have my phone number. I'd be happy to visit. And go into it in more detail if you'd like. Got a couple letters, same as last year. And again, I'm just going to start. There's one that's a single page letter, and then one that's a double page letter. As part of all audits, we're required to review the internal controls of the entity before we determine the auditing procedures that we're going to perform. We don't audit the internal controls, but we do evaluate it to determine the auditing procedures that we feel like we need to apply in order to express an unqualified opinion. So the single page letter, it's a front and a back. That's the letter regarding our review of the internal controls for the audit purposes. If there's a deficiency that we know, we're required to report that to you in writing. And we've got a couple things there that we've reported. One is well, actually, both of them are similar to the kind of carryovers from last year.
The first one deals with the processing of the payroll and the paying of the payroll liabilities and reconciling those prior to the actual payments being made. And we have a comment similar to that on last year's audit report. There was actually another comment and that had been resolved by the end of the year. This one was kind of a carryover and has been resolved now to where the processing of the payroll, this procedure is being performed before the payments for those payroll liabilities are being made. That's what that one is. The second one deals with the second one deals with the segregation of duties. A lot of our municipalities, smaller municipalities, have a similar comment, you know, where you just, there's not enough people in the accounting function to adequately segregate what would be considered ideal accounting controls. So, you know, our comment here is that, you know, just keep that in mind, and you do other things that help mitigate that. Josh reviews and approves purchase orders before they're paid. The board reviews and approves bills. You have three signatures on your checks, those kind of things. You review and approve, the financial reports. So the comment there is just keep in mind that that condition does exist and continue to do those other things that mitigate that. Does anybody have any questions on that? Okay, last one I have is called the communication that is charged with governance, which again would be the Board of Education. We're required to put in writing if we run into any instances where we run into difficulties performing the audit or if we have any disagreements with management over the application of accounting principles or the recording of a transaction on the books, those kind of things. I'm happy to say we didn't, and as you read through that, you'll notice it'll say we did not encounter any difficulties during the performance of the audit, and we didn't have any disagreements with the application of the accounting. So it's all positive things. The we also show the adjustments that were made to the books, and the two big ones are just the encumbrances that we just talked about, recording the encumbrance for the track and also for the fire alarm system. Those weren't on the books at the end of the year because they weren't paid until the next fiscal year.
We actually didn't pay for them until after July
1. After July 1, right. Okay. But since the agreement was signed prior to that, we felt like they should be encumbered. So, and again, it's out of capital outlay, so you have plenty of budget and plenty of cash. The last deal that's attached there is just the representation letter that basically just representations made to us during the audit. We just are required to put that in writing and basically says you provided us with all the information that we asked for. We're not aware of anything that's not recorded like it should be, that kind of stuff. So pretty much the same as last year on that, other than just changing the bill. Any questions on any of those reports?
Any questions for Mr. Bauer? Any motion to approve? Okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Sorry about my voice.
That's right. You're taking a motion to approve the audit?
Mr. President, I move that the board approve the 2014-15 audit report as presented.
Second. Moved and seconded to approve the 2014-15 audit report as presented. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 6-0.
Thank you, Mark.
Okay.
Thank you.
You'll have a good evening.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes. They are out in abundance, so at least for a few more days. Hey, thanks again.
Next item is information and discussion item, random drug testing policy.
This has come about with some discussions with the board and with our site council and some data we have showing usage among our students, not in school, but everywhere. And the most concerning thing, I think, was just how available drugs are to our kids. And the perception of our kids right now, or as of last year's data said, kids find it easier to get their hands on marijuana than they do alcohol. And I don't know what's driving that. Maybe our neighboring state has something to do with that. I don't know. But that's the reality of the world we live in. And we have drug dogs come to our campus, and we publicize that. The students know it. Our goal is not to catch the kids doing anything wrong. We just want it out of here. If that's something you choose to do, then keep it away from school. We have our code of conduct here. It's on page 25. Students signed this drug and alcohol policy. This was established some time ago by the board in this committee in 2006, actually. What it basically says is if students are using drugs or alcohol or tobacco off campus, that's really what this covers. Because if we're talking about on campus, it's a disciplinary situation. There would be suspensions. What we're talking about here is students participating in activities, association activities, and school activities. So if a student were to get caught with drugs outside of school on Saturday night, there's a consequence here. And that outlines all of this. The first violation, they're out for a week. The second violation has its own penalties and then moves on. And be more strict from there. So we already have this in place. And the site council and as a board, we've discussed with randomized drug testing, is that something we should look at for this code of conduct policy? Really, there's no way for us to tell if students are using on the weekend or away from school unless they admit to it, or if they're caught by the law enforcement, or if they admit it. Those are really the ways it comes about. Rumors about somebody, they're tough to substantiate. So that's, I guess, how this is all driven. So any questions about our current policy, what's in place there? Did everybody understand that we had that policy and we haven't had it?
And everyone that participates in extracurricular activity signs this?
Correct.
Don't you say they're out and to get caught or something? That's suspension from school?
No. Suspension from the activity. Okay. A good question. I already clarified that. When we're talking about usage away from school, we cannot suspend, we cannot discipline kids for their off-campus activities. So what we're talking about is voluntary activities they can be removed from. So if a kid gets arrested at a beer party on a Saturday night, gets a ticket for minor consumption, that suspension can only apply to extracurricular activities, not to school in general. Kids have a right to be at school. I sent you some policies. I don't expect you to read through all of those. That's what you pay me to do. But I did want to talk a little bit with the board about some things that go into this. So I got a short policy here from Columbus. This starts on page 26 on your iPad on the supporting documents. They start with a statement of purpose and intent. We hold our kids to higher standards, the ones that are in extracurricular activities. The goal is to prevent, and this school district is grade 7 through 12. So with our policy, we'd probably need to decide, would this be 7-12 or would this be 9-12? Would it include junior high or not? I don't think we want to get in a situation where we're any younger than that. And really, when we're talking about activities, it doesn't. We don't have those activities for younger kids. We spell out definitions very clearly. What all those things mean, what the extracurricular activities are. They have a spot for reasonable suspicion. If we have reasonable suspicion that a kid is under the influence at school, it could give us the opportunity to test a student at that time. They spell out some drug education session. You know, we've done those. And then it spells out the procedure. There would be a lot of questions of how do you do this, how do you do that, what if there's a false test, what if this, what if that. The policy would need to outline all those things ahead of time. And I don't have answers for what those things would be. But this particular policy spells that out. They get a copy of the policy. The parents must sign off. If they don't, they can't participate. And then it spells out how they, this particular school, they provide urine samples by, they have a random drawing. And, or any time there's reasonable suspicion. This particular school district, they have it under the direction of a professional laboratory. I would think we would do that as well. I don't want my administrators involved in any of that. Talks about the privacy between the laboratory and the student, and the student and the school, and the laboratory and the school. It says if initial drug test is positive, then it's subject to confirmation. So that would be a concern for parents. You know, what if my kid's on some medicine and that turns up positive? But that would be part of the conversation with the medical professional. What are the medicines? Is this a false positive? Well, they can have a second test. And this would allow the student, if they feel this been inaccurate, to appeal that decision and then appeal to the superintendent and then ultimately the school board. So then they spell out their violations. Our code of conduct, we would need to tweak a little bit for those violations. We need to tweak it anyway. According to our current code of conduct policy, if a student is selling cocaine on a Saturday night, or if another kid has a dip in his mouth on Saturday night, technically those are the same violation. And I think we would all agree those aren't equal offenses. So we do need to clean up some things anyway, whether we pursue the random drug testing or not. And then they spell out their offenses, what the consequence would be for each one. And I'm not going to go through all of these here. A refusal to submit. Most of these policies, they say if it's a refusal to submit for the test, then that's just like having a positive result. And then they have their form here. Again, I'm not going to go through all of this, but parents would sign off on it. The policy would have to be clearly communicated to everybody. Any questions about that, things that I need to be looking at in my research that you didn't see here, or you had questions about here?
Have they tweaked this a little bit with the current year? I mean, this says 13 and 14. I see it in writing here, but have they made some adjustments? Have you spoke?
I don't know the answer to that one on this one. I've got a sample policy from Pratt. Pratt just initiated this school year. So this is their first year doing it. At your place there, we have additional information. So while we're going through this, it's important. I've looked at all of these things. I sent these to you in an email also, but you've got a hard copy on your desk there. There's a local article, I think it was from this summer, about Pratt High School implementing their drug testing policy. Here's some research that supports random drug testing for students. And here's a couple of articles that have some research that are against it. So it's by no means unanimous that everybody thinks we should do it. There's some reasons to do it and some reasons not to do it. Down below those things, we'll make sure you understand this is not a comprehensive list. I did not get a response from every school that's a part of ESDAC. But I do know that these 2, 4, 6, 7 schools that are part of ESDAC do have random drug testing for students. And then here's a list of some that do not. And then there's some other schools I know that have it, just based on what I know, talking to administrators, and seeing their websites and things like that. So,
have you had a chance to visit with the superintendent?
I haven't about this. I visited with the principal at, well, he's a superintendent at Haven now. He was a principal at Mound Ridge, and they implemented a policy several years ago. And we've had some good conversations about it.
I just managed to know, Pratt, you know, how much they've used it in their first year, what they've learned.
Right. Yeah, they'll definitely be somebody I'm talking to.
Even cost of, like, the test and all that, you have any idea?
Your guess would be $50 a test. I know there's companies that do it for $50 a test. Our current bus driving pool, you know, they charge us by how many we have in the pool. When you have that many kids, you've got, a, you know, 115 kids in high school, I don't believe they'd be we'd be paying for the whole testing pool. So I know there's one out there that does them for about $50 a test. So if you were testing 5 kids, 5 kids a month for 9 months, that'd be about $2,250. So it's money. I mean, it is.
How comprehensive is the testing?
It can be very comprehensive. The more comprehensive it is, the more expensive it is. I know that.
So it's going to do just basic legal substances or illegal substances, but not necessarily K2 or some of the street things?
Probably, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. How often are you thinking about doing it?
I would guess it'd be monthly, but it could be every 2 weeks.
Hey, Rod.
Yeah.
You're going to get a few minutes
here. Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
We need to have our time with the superintendent.
I'm sorry.
So we'll get you here.
Is there going to be any provision for some kind of treatment or referrals to kids? Because I know we want it to be a preventative kind of thing, not just you've been bad.
Right.
So are we going to try to put anything in the policy that's going to be, okay, this is your second violation, now we're going to make a referral, or we'll give the students and their parents some contact information for programs?
Yes, okay. And that's very easy to do. Some people have asked, would the school district also pay for treatment for a student? And I think that's crossing a line in the family, what the family's responsibility would be. But yes, one thing we did, when I was at Burton, our code of conduct policy, we did not do random testing, but we did have a code of conduct policy. And it was something like, you know, the first offense, you were out for 9 weeks. If you went and got some counseling, then it was 2 weeks. So you had 2 weeks to get that drug counseling done. So that really put it on the kid that I messed up. It's not just I'm out. It's I've got to talk to somebody about this. So that's one way it could be handled, kind of force the issue to go get some help.
Results would be confidential?
Yes. And the parents would have to sign off. The parents and students would have to sign off that they could release that information to and school administration.
So is this something the public health nurse could do?
I don't know.
You talk about lab?
I don't think you want to come with any employee of the school involved in it. When we do it, it's always somebody outside that does the whole thing. That way it's hands off and you don't have any chance of any liability.
So you call on, like if you know that you're going to do it a certain day, then you call that lab to be here or what?
It's always random scheduled when we do it. It all depends what provider you use. A lot of times they, the two different ones I've dealt with, they'll notify a person at the school and come on the next day, and then they'll have a list of the people. The school's out of, or whatever organization is out of picking the students, they're out of that part. Mm-hmm. So that way everything's handled extra. Right.
Any other questions or direction for me as I'm researching this?
I think cost would definitely be something we'd look at. The other is, you know, do all schools use a urine test, or is there hair sample, saliva? What, I mean, we don't want to be too intrusive to the students, but yet we need something accurate. Mm-hmm. This won't stop them from doing anything, but if it's a discouragement.
Right.
I don't think we'd want to use hair tests for the random stuff, though, because you have to, it has to have been at least 2 to 6 weeks for it to show up. So that's, and that's the most expensive one, so I don't think we want to do that. But I dealt with a lot of families and students in drug court in Kansas City, and I think that we need to look at the difference between UAs and the saliva test, and which ones can give us the most information on the drugs that we're most likely to find in our school. Marijuana is going to stay in the system longer, but with a UA you can dilute it. So, you know, what's going to cost, but what's also going to get us to the information we need? Cost effective. Yeah, but is that going to help us with what the kids have access to?
Any other questions from the board? You're going to continue to learn?
Yes. Yeah. I will have something after Christmas as far as a policy worked up to tweak. And then before school's out, we would have something to vote on. So that would be the goal, to have something to present in the, you know, this winter or spring.
Anything else? Okay, Rodney? We've got about 3 minutes here.
Yeah, I'm not against the drug test. I'm really not. I just want to make sure you get carried away with it. Everything you talked about so far, that you're not against it, is okay. But I do know this, yeah, 3 weeks ago, and I didn't see you. I used to sit home and read the damn computer screen for 6 hours a day. I haven't slept in 3 goddamn weeks either. The biggest program that they got in the state right now is Parkhurst High School in Tupelo, Kansas City. It's a private Jesuit school. They're doing hair stuff. They're taking hair samples. And it's expensive. And it takes, you have to send it into a lab. The urine sample that most places use that I've ever been with in employment anyway, you read them on the spot. I mean, just as soon as you put a drop of urine on the damn tester, they'll say, we've got a list right beside it, and they'll light all of them up. And in the schools that are really into it, if they get a false test but the kid is acting strange, they can call somebody or the testing outfit and give them a breathalyzer for alcohol. You know. So they can't really hide anything. Now, there are a few things on the market you can buy over the counter. You can drink that stuff, and you go in within 5 minutes, and then you get a negative test. There's not very many of them. But I click on them sites further, and they tell you right where to go and get the ingredients to put with something else that'll make it hide that stuff too. So you got to deal with that. And it's crazy. Now, the other thing, the big thing I'm reading, I don't know what the cost is going to be. I know $50 is a pretty good, you know, average cost. I've found online anywhere from 30 to 100. And that just came to school. That just came to school. Let's see here. The ACLU, they're all over the field. I'll tell you that right now. I mean, you're watching. You've been watching since 1996. I think the El Dorado, they're on the list. They've been doing it, I think, 2006, something like that. And they got something like that, what you're talking about, Josh. You know, if they don't sign that consent form at the beginning of the year, they don't go out for nothing. But their administrators, since 2006, their administrators insist that their school doesn't have any drug problem. The testing is into keeping it that way, okay? I suppose, smart as these kids are, if they're going to figure out a way to get around drug tests, you know, they're going to do it. May, they spent $31,000 in 5 years in couple, and had four positive tests.
Who was that?
May. Two-tenths of 1% of their student body. Mm-hmm. And so they had to, in order to pay for that, without raising anything up, you know, tax writing, you know, they had to cut field trips and, you know, other activities. They had to cut that out. Just this year, the Journal of Pediatrics and the National Pediatric Group and the American Medical Association just this year in April. They found no evidence that random drug testing prevents drug abuse, found that the testing strains the relationship between the students and their schools, administrators and teachers. Testing only students and activities and that for drive to school with their own personal vehicle and park on school property largely misses the mark of the kids that you think are using the drug. Because the kids that are out for sports or in band or something like that, they're not the dope. They're not the kids you do the dope. Dr. Jennifer Millick, Vice President of Kansas Chapter of Nursing Academy of Pediatrics, she thinks it's a waste of money and a waste of time. She thinks train teachers and recognize what to look for and everything, you know, with the kid using it. And you got to have a good counselor that's up with substance abuse and all that. And you got to have outside resources to give them treatment if they're really that far over the line. And she finds that's the way to do it. Now, how often do the dogs come in here?
Five times a year.
Does that cost?
Yes, it costs.
Okay. Have they ever had a positive hit on a locker or anything?
Not on a locker, a vehicle.
Okay, a vehicle. Was it on school property?
Yes. Okay.
What can you guys do in that situation?
Well, then it's a school discipline issue. There can be suspensions and expulsions there.
Okay. Did anything happen on that one instance?
Well, I can't really talk about specific incidents.
Well, I don't know what you said.
Yes. Yep.
I don't know. It's a real touchy subject. I mean, everything I've found on it, such a big deal this day. And they still haven't sorted out the Supreme Court ruling what they can do and what they can't do. And I'm not against it. I hate to get them carried away, and especially the way the town is. If you're involved in law, if you involve law enforcement, they can get out of everybody's hands right quick. That's the worst thing out in the world I want to see. If you're not doing that kid any good, and then go to the court system. My turn, I tell you, they're not going to get treatment. The only treatment they're going to get is a juvenile detention facility, and they're going to come back to about five times working with her. They're going to know what the hell to do next time. Nobody's going to like it. I don't like suspension or expulsion from school, and I don't think anybody's really doing that. Just suspend them from that activity, and then they bar them if they keep doing nothing. So I just want, I didn't just hear answer some questions. Like I said, I say every night or at least 3 weeks. You Google it on there, and I mean just start going down the list, and it's on and on and on. And I couldn't find any place that said that they really thought it was helping. I really don't. I was not a one of them.
Well, Rodney, we're just in the information fact gathering stage. You're welcome to speak with any of the board members anytime. And
Right. Mr. Meyer.
Okay. So I didn't know how far along you guys were.
We're just starting.
Wow.
We're just starting. So thank you for speaking your mind. Okay. KASB convention delegate. Is anyone interested in going this year?
It's in Wichita. I sent you a quick schedule, snapshot of what they do, what's on the agenda. So if somebody would like to go, our fee is paid for. I try to get to that each year, but I'll be out of town that weekend. So
I've gone the last 2 years. It's a really informative convention. You have to visit with a lot of other school board members. I'm not able to go this year either. If anyone else would be interested in going.
Anybody thinks they might, we could just assign you as our delegate for the delegate assembly. We have a say in what KSB puts out as their legislative positions and those things. So that happens at the delegate assembly on that Sunday, and we have a vote in that. So if somebody thinks they might go, we could assign you as a delegate.
Is it possible to go to just that?
Yes.
Because I would be interested in going to just that, but because of my oxygen, I can't commit right now to doing anything that would involve more than an overnight
sure.
stay.
And that's on Sunday, right?
That's on Sunday.
Yes. Sunday afternoon. Okay. Isn't it afternoon?
I'll have to find the time.
I think it was on something that we got in the mail.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
I could go down for some of the general sessions if she wants to vote.
We can have Debbie vote. You go if you can.
Do they get the resolutions out ahead of time?
Yes.
That's what they're doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we can put Debbie down as a delegate and Barb as the alternate. Anybody else maybe think they might go, we can put you down. If you think you might want to go, please let me know. I'll get you signed up.
When does it have to be submitted by?
As far as the registration, it can be a walk-in. So.
Okay.
If somebody wants to go and be the for the whole thing, and be the delegate, I'm fine with that. But if you just need a delegate, I would be able to go on Sunday.
There's nobody guarding the door. You can just go in.
Okay.
Sit down.
I do have to submit paperwork as to who is the delegate.
Yeah.
Go for
it. All right. So Debbie is the delegate. Barb, you want to be the delegate?
I'll be an alternate.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Can we put that in motion form?
Sure. Mr. President, I move that the board approve Debbie as the delegate for the 2015 KSB convention with Barb as the alternate.
Second.
Second.
Well, you know what?
You can't.
Stacy's going to have surgery on the 4th. Maybe I shouldn't.
Do you know what you
volunteer.
I'm sorry.
Okay, I'm going to back out.
Can you put me down and I'll see?
You want to amend your motion?
Sure. Mr. President, I'd like to amend my motion and move that the board approve Debbie as the delegate for the 2015 KSB convention with myself as the alternate.
Second amendment.
Amendment motion. It's been moved and seconded that the board approve Debbie as the delegate for the 2015 KSB convention with Derek as the alternate. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Motion carries 6-0. Thank you, Debbie. Maintenance pickup.
We did find a nice little pickup to purchase. We've been working on that for some time now. We got a 2005 Ford F-150. Books out at about $8,100. And Jim Green is asking $6,300. We've had it checked out by a different mechanic. And, we've driven it the last few days. And It's in really good shape. There's a picture of it. It's not red.
Good job.
Yeah. So I'd recommend we purchase that pickup.
Mr. President, I move that the board approve the purchase of the Ford F-150 at the price of $6,300 from GNS Motor.
Second that.
Move and second the board approve the purchase of the Ford F-150 at a price of $6,300 from GNS Motor. Any discussion? Not all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 6-0. Neighborhood revitalization plan?
This is a pretty standard. Page 34 is the agreement. We've been a part of this neighborhood revitalization plan. We need to be a part of that because we're a taxing entity. What it does, if you improve your property, improve a building, it offers some tax rebates for that. So this has just chicken scratches on it. So I'm not going to go through this whole thing for you, but I guess the downside to this is if somebody improves their property and tax rebates are given, that comes off of our tax rolls. So we get less tax money when somebody does that. But if they don't improve their property, we don't get that anyway. So I guess my philosophy is if this will encourage any sort of growth or improvements on properties, I think it's a positive thing. So thinking short term, we won't get that tax revenue, but long term, we will. So, anybody have any questions about kind of what that entails? One of you is appointed as the board's appointee for that group. Whenever they have an application come in, we would meet and go through it. So, I can't tell you who it is.
You're the last one.
Always called me.
So that's the agreement. We need to approve that. The neighborhood revitalization plan.
Why do we want to cut this off?
Well, that's current.
Any questions on that? If not, entertain motion to approve.
Mr. President, the board approves the neighborhood revitalization plan through 2020.
Second.
Move to second that the board approve the neighborhood revitalization plan through 2020. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries 6-0. We've got a building tour on the agenda?
Yep.
So we'll recess for the building tour.
We had SEC meeting, and there wasn't anything major that was discussed at that one. I'm not going to be able to go next week if anyone would like to go on that place.
What Monday is it?
Next Monday.
16.
Are you going to be there, Mr. Moore?
I'm going to plan to.
Okay.
Yeah. I can go.
I'll get you that information and then mail it to me. Okay. Thank you.
No, I don't have any.
I don't have anything. Sorry, Debbie, were you finished? You mean cut you
off
there? Okay. All right. Mr. Meyer?
Our principals are at their fall principals conference today and tomorrow. So that's why they're not here. I think that's it. Important thing for them to do, they'll pick up a lot of good ideas and see things that other schools do. So that's some of their professional development. The other enrollment numbers there. The class leadership activity, we've got a group of kids that were selected by staff to participate in this. We hosted a gentleman out at the lodge. Some of the lodge gentlemen, it's in Crookin', Carl and Todd. So thank you for that. Serve lunch. So they do a lot of neat things, just developing leadership skills in those kids. So, individual career plans of study. This is really focused on getting kids to understand what they need to take and why they need to take it. What is, you know, we're asking kids to pick what's your career. You know, when they're in eighth grade, what do you want to do? And they're not pigeonholed into that, but at least when they go to say, well, I want to be a doctor, but I don't really like science. Well, then something's not right there. Let's take more science or change what you want to do. That's okay, but... So our goal with this is to get our teachers more involved in that process, knowing what the kids want to do. We did have parent-teacher conferences. I'm sorry I didn't have numbers to give you on that. Scholars Bowl's going now. Junior high basketball starts this week. All school play, I think Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And then mentioned he's at his conference. So, and then Travis's report, his numbers. next week we'll have an early dismissal for staff development on Wednesday. They're going to discuss ways to, how do we celebrate student successes? That's been one focus that I've directed the principals on. We need to celebrate those things more. You know, we do a good job of celebrating, you know, the athletics banquet at the end of the year, but what do we do for our kids? We have our senior night. What else? We need to publicize those positive things for our kids in the classroom. Also, standards-based grade cards. He went over that with the board a while back. Have a winter concert coming up. A couple of pictures here. PTO's working on adding some decorations to our fences right out here on 5th Street where the playground is. And then up at the football field. So I think they're going to try to get one of those done. Maybe this one out here before too long here. And then maybe another one this spring. My report, I have a PowerPoint I want to go over with you. It has a video, but my voice is running out. And it's not going to hurt to postpone this for another month. So, and we're getting late. I'm going to hold off on that. English language learners are kids that come in that speak a different language at home. We need to do a better job with those kids. And we've got a team together now to find out what we can do. Some schools, they pull kids out of class, and they have their own classroom and work with those kids. We don't have many of those kids that just don't speak very good English. But we also don't understand when a kid speaks very good English, maybe the kid doesn't know how to read well. And that's conversational English. So there still might be language struggles because they didn't learn English as their first language that our teachers can do a better job with. So we've got some professional development going on through the state with that to help us do a better job. The Supreme Court case, they heard oral arguments. In a nutshell, this is for the equity part. Schools with lower property valuation compared to high property valuation. That equity is out of balance, and the lower court said you need to fix that. They did, but then they changed their mind, so now the Supreme Court is hearing that again. So what's in question now is the equity part. It doesn't really affect us because we don't get any of that money. So the state budget is a problem still. Just in the last couple of days, they've come out that revenues are lower than expected. The budget's in the red. The new consensus revenue estimates moving forward, they lowered those. So they had to cut $118 million just to get back to zero, just to be broke. The governor made some adjustments, about $124 million. That leaves $6 million in the bank at the end of the year, which is basically zero with the size of the budget. That's going to be an ongoing problem for us. And the situation doesn't look any better next year. So we do have to be very conservative of what we do moving forward. And I think it's going to take real revenue reform at the state level unless we're going to keep cutting. So, the track resurfacing, I've been here and got some painting done and got a little more done. And fighting the wind has been the problem. So they're getting there. They've got lines on. They've got the relay zones in, but painting the lane numbers and the letters. Not done with that yet. Already mentioned the classroom doors should be over Thanksgiving. The marquee sign replacement. Jared Taylor and Mitch Menace, they're both on the site council, and so is Ryan Witt. And part of Pete Witt's memorial, family wanted to update our sign, our marquee sign. So this is what they came up with. Mitch can get this at basically wholesale cost done. This would replace that marquee sign that's out there. They'd like to put it up on a concrete foundation, maybe up a couple of feet, and something similar to this. And the second page of that shows it'd be about $8,000 plus delivery. I think there's $3,000 or $4,000 from Pete Witzman. So, any thoughts on this sign to replace our marquee sign?
How wide is that?
I don't know what that one is there.
I think it's
8 foot.
Okay.
Yeah. 8 by 3.5.
So is it going to be in black?
That's what they're recommending. Yeah, is that dark gray or black? And then it will be whitewashed on the, or etched, I guess, on the letters.
Can't do blue, huh?
I don't know.
Probably no blue stone.
I've never seen blue granite. Huh? I've never seen blue granite.
Or white with blue letters, but I probably look dirty on this one.
Well, feel free to send me your thoughts on that in an email or let me know later, whatever you think.
Where's the rest of the money coming from?
We the capital outlay.
Okay.
Looks nice.
Mm-hmm. I like it.
It's better than an overgrown marquee sign.
Yeah.
Is it possible to get something like what they have in the library just for continuity? You know, the library has a curtain. I guess I should have mentioned that at their meeting, not you, but at the site council meeting.
Oh, that white concrete wall? Is that what you're saying?
Where they have Eidolon Goodman, they have that kind of curved sign out in front of there.
Is that marble?
No,
it's not.
It's just concrete. Concrete.
I like this, but I just thought that would kind of draw them together.
Mm-hmm. I may ask them to come discuss it with the board. See if we want to do that. Very appreciative of them getting that together. That's all I have on my report.
Okay. Mr. Meyer, executive session items tonight. We have Mr. Meyer's superintendent evaluation. Anything else?
I've got a few items, and none of them should take very long.
Okay. Any action after?
No action.
Okay. We probably need 15 minutes for the evaluation.
We'll start there.
15 minutes.
Mr. President, I move the board go into executive session to discuss personnel matters in order to protect the privacy of non-elected personnel with Mr. Meyer be included. And that we return to open session in 15 minutes in this room.
Second.
So move the board go into executive session to discuss personnel matters in order to protect the privacy of non-elected personnel with Mr. Meyer to be included. And that we return to open session in 15 minutes. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried 6-0.